Is Lemtrada right for you? Or more generally, who's the right patient to take Lemtrada? I'm going to give you my opinion on the answer to that question in this video, so don't turn away, because that starts right now. Howdy. Thanks for learning about MS with me, Aaron Boster. I started this YouTube channel to help my own MS clinic patients learn between visits. And it's my hope that through these videos, I can help you learn too. Today's video is focusing on a question I'm commonly asked. Hey Aaron, who's the right patient to go on Lemtrada, codename for alemtuzumab? Now, as many of you who have watched this channel know, I'm a big fan of Lemtrada. I think it's a highly effective therapy. And I'll throw some cards up above that link you to videos I've done on how Lemtrada works in case you want to check that out. I'll also include links down in the description below. Most of the time, when people ask me who's the right patient, I think they expect an answer of a list of risk factors that would predispose someone for aggressive disease. And those could be things like being a male, being African American, having spinal cord disease, having frequent MS attacks, incomplete recovery from attacks, quick accrual of neurological disability, heavy burden of disease on the brain MRI, frequent MRI spots, frequent enhancing spots. I could go on. Now, I just listed a bunch of risk factors that would predispose one given human to have increased disability progression or a faster disability or a worse outcome compared to someone that didn't have those risk factors. And it stands to reason that someone with those risk factors might benefit from a highly aggressive therapy or from a really efficacious therapy like Lemtrada. And whereas I don't agree with that, that's not how I think we should make the decision. That's not how I delineate the person in whom we might consider Lemtrada or not. I think before we consider risk factors, we have to take one step back and ask quite literally a philosophical question. The philosophical question is, how do you want to approach this disease? How do you want to try to beat MS? And really, there's a branch point. There's two options that we have to consider with the current FDA-approved therapies in 2018. The most common way of treating MS is to use an escalation model with continuous therapies. What I mean by that is, all the other therapies that are FDA-approved, except Lemtrada, are continuous therapies. You continually take them on a regular basis, whether that be a pill once a day, or a shot once a week, or an infusion once a month, or an infusion once every 6 months. The point is you're doing something on a continual basis. And there's nothing wrong with that. In fact, that's the most common way of treating the condition. Now, I mentioned escalation because most commonly, people start, folks with MS, when they're using this escalation model, on a medicine that might be mild to moderately effective, but might have a really nice side effect profile. And if everything works out, they continue it. And if they have worsening disease, they upgrade. Now, I have my own personal opinions about that. And again, I'll leave a link up above and I'll include a link in the description below about my opinions on escalation therapy. For this video, I want to point out that is the most common way of treating MS. There's an alternate option created with Lemtrada. And that's an option for immune reconstitution, or rebooting the immune system, or as I like to say, induction therapy. And it's rather different philosophically than escalation. With induction therapy, you're hitting the disease really, really hard up front. You're literally ablating the naughty immune cells and you're rebooting the immune response. And that comes with upfront risk, upfront cost, and a lot of monitoring that has to take place in the short term, the few years right after the induction. But a large percentage of patients don't need retreatment. And in fact, looking at the 8-year long-term follow-up data for Lemtrada, over 50% of patients went out 8 years and never got retreated. About 30% needed a third course. And so clearly this is a discontinuous therapy. So going back to this question of who's the right patient for Lemtrada, I think you can answer it first philosophically. How do you want to treat the disease? Are you someone who would like to start with a mild to moderately effective drug in groups of people, but with a great safety profile, something that you could take for life if needed, and then see how things go? And if things work out great, stay on that therapy, and if they don't, then escalate. And most patients, in my experience, are most comfortable doing that. But there's another cadre of patients, These are people that want a chance at improvement. They want a chance at slowing brain volume loss. They want a chance of no evidence of disease activity. They want the highest likelihood of trying to achieve that, and they are willing to accept a degree of risk and a degree of complexity up front in order to have that opportunity. Now, I still think all those risk factors that I rattled off earlier are valuable. I'm not trying to tell you differently. But I have found in talking to hundreds upon hundreds of families with MS that people quickly delineate into one of these two categories. When I describe Lemtrada to patients and families in my clinic room, I find that very quickly they polarize. Now they either say, no thank you doc, I don't want to do that, or they say, tell me more. And I really think that we have to settle this idea philosophically of which way we want to treat the disease before we take next steps. So there you have it. A couple of opinions on who's the right patient for Lemtrada. My answer, it's a philosophical one. The person that's willing to accept upfront degree of risk for the chance at long-term benefit without retreatment, as compared to someone that might be more concerned about ongoing long-term safety and is willing to use an escalation model to try to find that risk balance. There isn't a right answer. It's not like one is good and one is bad. I think that they're different, and I think it's awesome that we have options available. Once again, my name is Aaron Boster, and thank you for taking a few moments to learn about MS with me. I would be very curious about your opinions. What do you think? Please leave your comments and your questions down in the section below. And if you like this video, please feel free to give it a like. And if you'd like to hear more content like this, please take a moment and subscribe to the channel. Until my next video, take care.